protection offered quadrivalent vaccine is cost effective. Then efficacy studies of quadrivalent influenza in children talks about they are more effective. To conclude, influenza is a different from common cold, constantly evolves and goes under the antigenic drift and antigenic shift, is a deadly disease, it's a costly disease, quadrivalent fits test the best current influenza epidemiology and the most effective way to prevent influenza and severe outcomes from influenza vaccination. This is the last slide, and this talks about why we should have inclusion of influenza vaccines in the national programs. Thank you for quite listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Lalit, for bringing out the differences between common cold and influenza, because most of the time general public take it just the same, and the importance of vaccination, especially in the healthcare workers. And this time again, India is probably bearing the burden. And
yes.
Up to this month, we had around 500 deaths, and unfortunately, Rajasthan is one of the state which has the. If somebody has, and if I know that I develop it, then probably I should be not visiting all those places for at least for 5 days. That's the best way to prevent. And vaccination efficacy is one issue basically with this vaccine. So I think we'll take that in question and answer session. And thank you very much. You can take the.
Thank you very much.
And then we'll invite you. Now it's my pleasure to invite Dr. Madhu. She is our own alumni, and she is currently the professor in community medicine and School of Public Health in PGIMR Chandigarh. And she is working on vaccine with quite interest. I had been associated for last 6-7 years, and she is going to talk about two very important vaccines. Probably these are the vaccines which are neglected, at least especially in the government sector, and we don't have much of knowledge. This typhoid vaccine started journey way back in 1839. That vaccine, then it disrupted everything, and same is for HPV, because people are still not sensitized. So Madhu, it's over to you.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity, and also our collaborators. So why I have chosen these two vaccines, because currently the debate is going on whether we should be introducing these vaccines in our national immunization schedule or not. So I'll be starting first with the typhoid vaccine. What is the status? Briefly about the epidemiology. So typhoid, as we know, that it is caused by Salmonella typhi, which is a gram-negative bacteria. And it is responsible for over 26 million in enteric fever cases globally, around 75,000 to 210,000 deaths in low and middle income countries per year. It is virtually eliminated in developed countries, mainly because of the hygienic and sanitary conditions, and also there is a use of vaccine in those countries. In South Asia, the incidence is around 394 cases per 100,000 person years. And majority of strains are resistant to common antibiotics. Now, the problem in India is that, it is treatable by antibiotic use, but there is an upsurge of antimicrobial resistance. And also because of this multi-drug resistant H58 clade in the Indian subcontinent, which is why it is a cause of concern. So also there are recent reports of resistance to the last line of antibiotics. So which was earlier treatable, now it is another problem. And it is becoming difficult and expensive to treat. And it is easy to control this disease because humans are the only known reservoirs. And transmission, as we know, is through fecal-oral route. So if you look at the literature, till now, there are these cohort studies which are available. According to these are quite old cohort studies which give us estimate about the incidence. So one was conducted in Delhi by Sinha et al. And which says that the incidence between 2 to 4 years is around 2,700 per 100,000 child years of observation. And it is more than between 5 to 19 years and over 19 years. This is contrary to our belief that this disease is located, or it is among the school-going children, which was more than 5 years or 5 to 15 years. We have seen reported high incidence between children of 2 to 4 years. Similarly, although the incidence reported was less in the Sur et al. Study in Kolkata, but the incidence in the 2 to 4 years of age was high. And similarly, in this slide, it has been shown that incidence in the younger age group was higher. A recent systematic review and meta-analysis of studies on typhoid fever in children in Asia and Africa found that estimates of the proportion of typhoid fever cases in those aged less than 5 years was around 14 to 29%, 5 to 9 years, 30 to 44%, and between 10 to 14 years is around 28 to 52%. And if you look at the lab estimates, the estimate prevalence of lab-confirmed typhoid and paratyphoid among individuals with fever across all hospital studies was 9.7% and 0.9% respectively. So this shows that there is a problem of typhoid. Summary of the available evidence shows that cohort studies show high incidence of typhoid, especially among young children. And incidence and prevalence estimates reveal heterogeneity. There is a decline in typhoid isolation and complications at tertiary care facilities, more so in the past decade. And this has led to perception that there is a declining trend of the burden. And hospital surveillance is likely biased and underestimate the incidence because of antibiotic practices which confound the disease burden. And antimicrobial resistance might unmask disease burden in the future. So, NTAGI, all of you know that this is a national technical advisory group which takes decision that whether a vaccine should be introduced into the in the national immunization schedule or not. So, for them, there are these queries like what is the current incidence of typhoid fever? Is the disease heterogeneously distributed? And what is the complication or case fatality rate? And what is the cost effectiveness of using the typhoid vaccines? So, in a bid to answer these questions, we already have set up national surveillance system for enteric fever in India to establish these answers. Why I have brought this into in this forum, because then we will be able to correlate that why typhoid vaccines and which type of typhoid vaccine will be useful. So with this background, I'll be coming to the status of currently available typhoid vaccines. So different types of typhoid vaccines are, as Dr. Ashwani has also mentioned, that first vaccine was available in the 19th century. So that was older first generation inactivated whole cell vaccine, which was available. And the production of this vaccine has been stopped. Second generation are these live attenuated oral typhi 21A vaccine. This is a licensed vaccine. And typhoid VI polysaccharide injectable vaccines. Third generation vaccines are typhoid conjugate vaccines, which have a better immunogenicity. And the common vaccines among these are TIP-VAR TCB or PIDATEV, which is available in Indian setting. And the fourth generation vaccines, which are currently, the trials are going on, are paratyphi conjugate vaccines. So second and third generation vaccines are licensed. So briefly about the live attenuated oral typhi 21A, this requires, as the name indicates, it's available in the tablet form and requires 4 doses of an oral capsule separated by 48 hours. It is an entirely coated tablet. This vaccine requires a booster every 2 years if continued exposure and revaccination every 5 years. The vaccine schedule should be completed at least 1 week before potential exposure. The vaccine is approved for patients 6 years of age and older. And it is a live vaccine, so should not be given in pregnancy and to immunocompromised patients like HIV or those on cancer therapy. So this was first licensed in Europe in 1983 and in US in 1989. These are some of the side effects, and as you can see, side effects are minor, like abdominal pain, nausea, headache, fever. And these were similar in the placebo group, which was found in the clinical trials. Coming to Typhim VI, which is typhoid polysaccharide injectable vaccine for typhoid. Vaccination with this vaccine induces an increase in anti-VI antibodies. In a trial in Kathmandu, Nepal, it was found that 74% of the infection was prevented in children ages 2 to 4. This was 20-month follow-up. However, the efficacy is around 50 to 60% of this vaccine. It is to be given by either intramuscular or subcutaneously. Only requires a single dose with a booster every 3 years. Storage is at 2 to 8 degrees centigrade, and currently the cost is around $300 per dose. And this was first licensed in US in 1994. Adverse effects, malaise, headache, nausea, diarrhea, and injection site reactions as with other vaccines could be there. However, no serious adverse reactions were observed in clinical trials. Polysaccharide vaccines have a limited efficacy, as we have learned that single dose of this vaccine in the year one efficacy is around 69%, year two 59%, and year three cumulative efficacy of the vaccine is around 55%. This is as per the Cochrane review. So hence there was a need for a better typhoid vaccine. Maybe typhoid conjugate vaccine was the answer. So there are two type of typhoid conjugate vaccine where with the polysaccharide a protein is attached. So if the tetanus toxoid is attached, it is VITT. And if a recombinant exoprotein A, Pseudomonas aeruginasa, it is VIREPA. So advantages of conjugate vaccines are that this is a polysaccharide vaccine and it causes antibody production. But with this type of vaccine, which is conjugated with the protein, there is an additional component of T cell and it provides immunity through T cell also. This is the added advantage of conjugated vaccines. So it was first licensed in India in 2013 to be given intramuscularly. Age is between 6 months to 45 years. So if the first dose is given between 9 months to 2 years, you have to repeat one more dose after 2 years and can be used 9 months onwards. If the dose is given after 2 years, only one dose is enough. Efficacy is comparable to the polysaccharide vaccines, but more robust, as we have seen in the previous slide. The immune response is better and it is more robust. Storage is as usual between 2 to 8 degrees, and BVM is available. Costly vaccine costs around $1,500 per dose, and protection may persist till 5 years. Co-administration of these three vaccines, the oral vaccine, polysaccharide, and this conjugate vaccine, there is an evidence there is no interference with the immune response of if we give this vaccine with other vaccines like measles, mumps, and rubella, or with hepatitis A vaccine, or polio and cholera and yellow fever vaccine, because most of the time this vaccine is given to the travelers who are traveling to the endemic areas. Regarding cost effectiveness, available modeling data indicate that routine vaccination of infants with TCV plus catch-up vaccination of older cohorts provides additional benefits towards accelerated and sustained decline in typhoid fever incidence compared with the routine vaccination alone. So another review, this is a Cochrane review. This is quite recent, in the last May 2018 it came. So according to this review, it says that licensed typhi 21A and polysaccharide vaccines are efficacious in adults and children older than 2 years in endemic countries. And this VIREPA is just efficacious, although data is only available for children. According to this review, the new VITT vaccine requires further evaluation as there was just one single trial. If we look at the recommendation by the Strategic Advisory Group of Experts on Immunization on the typhoid vaccine, they recommend the introduction of typhoid vaccine for infants and children over 6 months of age as single dose in endemic countries, followed by catch-up vaccination up to 15 years. They also recommend that surveillance of typhoid fever should be done to know the exact burden of the disease and also to monitor antibiotic-resistant strains for typhoid. Then we have this WHO position paper on typhoid vaccine, which came out last year. And WHO definitely recommends programmatic use of typhoid vaccine for the control of typhoid fever, especially in the endemic countries. TFE is preferred at TCV, it's a conjugate vaccine. It is preferred at all ages in view of its improved immunological properties and suitability for younger children. The advantage is that it can be given to infants or children less than 2 years, and expected longer duration of protection. So, however, it also recommends that other like other vaccines, polysaccharide and oral vaccine can also be given. And this is the schedule, primary vaccination for conjugate vaccine. It is single dose from 6 months to 45 years. Polysaccharide vaccine, single dose more than 2 years. And oral typhi, 3 dose oral dose for children more than 6 years. And they have recommended catch up with the single dose for with the TCV conjugate vaccine up to 15 years. So that was about typhoid vaccine. Now coming to another debatable vaccine, whether we should be introducing this in our national immunization schedule or not, is the human papilloma virus vaccine. The epidemiology and virology, oncogenic virus types 16 and 18 of this virus, human papilloma virus, they are most commonly involved in causing cervical cancer cases in 70% of the cases. And it was observed that in 2012, around 5 lakh cases of cervix, cancer cervix, was because of, there was this many number of cervical cancer cases and 2 lakh deaths worldwide because of cervical cancer. And 80% cases were in less developed regions. So this is definitely a public health problem. Pathogenicity, HPV type 6 and 11 also cause anogenital warts, recurrent respiratory papillomatosis, vaginal, vulval, penile, oropharyngeal, and anal cancer. There are 3 types of HPV vaccines that are available. These are based upon recombinant DNA technology using non-infectious virus-like particles, VLP. So bivalent is Cervarix, which is licensed in 2007. Then quadrivalent is Gardasil, licensed in 2006. And nanovalent, which has 9 strains, Gardasil 9, which is licensed in 2014. So Cervarix bivalent is by GlaxoSmithKline. So it is it has strains against 16 and 18 types of HPV. Efficacy is around 93% to 98% against carcinoma in situ stage 2 and 3. Cost is around 1800 per dose, and it is safe, and it is to be given to boys as well as girls. Dose which is recommended is that between 9 to 14 years, 2 doses should be given. After first dose, it should be given after 2 months, and up till 6 months, the second dose can be given. For more than 15 years, 3 doses at 0-1-6 months is to be given. The Gardasil quadrivalent has strains like active against 4 strains, 6, 11, 16, and 18. Efficacy is almost similar to bivalent vaccine, little higher. Cost is 2500 per dose to be given to all. But for Gardasil, 2 doses are to be given for children between 9 to 13 years. And for more than 14 years, single dose is sufficient. 3 doses are to be given. For Gardasil, which is a 9-valent, nanovalent, the other strains for which it is effective, 6, 11, 16, 18, 31, 33, 45, 52, and 58. So it covers additional 15% of cervical cancers. Efficacy is around 96.7%, and this is also safe. The dose is similar to Cervarix type of vaccine. HPV vaccines are to be administered before the onset of sexual activity, that is before first exposure to HPV infection to girls as well as to boys. However, in most of the recommendations, it has been recommended that at least to the girls it should be given. WHO come out with its position paper in the year 2017, and they say that HPV vaccination should be introduced into National Immunization Schedule program, where prevention of cervical cancer and or other HPV-related disease is a public health priority, and India falls in that category. The introduction is programmatically feasible and economically sustainable. That is also one of the criteria, and where cost-effectiveness aspects have been duly considered. So these are the recommendations of WHO. I found this review article which says that HPV vaccine in vaccination in India, critical appraisal, and according to them, there are barriers like cost efficacy, then social acceptance, like for the parents, like in India, sexual activity is not generally started at 9 years of age. So socially, it is little difficult to convince the parents that their child needs this vaccine. So they concluded that instead of vaccine, maybe screening of the women should be done so that early detection of the cervical cancers can be done and they are treated. So however, they say that cost is not the biggest problem and recommended that improved coverage of screening should be done and focus of screening should be on women more than 30 years. So this is another angle of whether to introduce this vaccine in the national immunization schedule or not. However, Punjab state has introduced the HPV vaccine in 2016. This is from their own state health budget. So we have written the experience of Punjab state and it has been published. So they had introduced this vaccine in two districts of Punjab, Bathinda and Mansa. So where they are giving immunization to all the girls between 9 to 15 years of age in the schools. We have also, our department have also done a study on looking at the cost effectiveness aspect in Punjab. So, and they have observed that HPV vaccine appears to be very cost effective strategy for Punjab state, and it is likely to be cost effective for other Indian states as well. Then there was this Entagi recommendation on HPV, which came out in 2017, and according to them, HPV vaccine, which has the highest valency, that means the which is more effective against the strains, is recommended for which has more number of strains, is recommended for inclusion in India's universal immunization. So Entagi has actually recommended that it should be included in the national immunization schedule. Current policy will be to immunize girls only. The current scenario of HPV vaccine is, it is not included in the national immunization schedule, as we all know, and it could be because of the high cost of vaccine, lack of public awareness. So there's a need to make it more cost effective. Make in India vaccines can be made available, like Serum Institute Private India Limited. They are working on developing this vaccine, and PJ is one of the sites where this phase 3 vaccine trial is being conducted. So with that, I would like to thanks. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Madhu. Nicely sticking to the time schedule and briefly introducing again with the typhoid vaccine, we'll take one, two comments and then we'll take the questions. Again, the prevention is the first and foremost. It's basically the personal hygiene and safe water and discreta. Second is with typhoid vaccine, we have this conjugate vaccine, but the issue is that studies are, follow-up is a very limited period. So one need not to go over a period of time how much efficacy this vaccine is going to be there. But vaccine is important in the sense that during 2 months back, we had one outbreak in the our near neighbor, who is already in the news these days, Pakistan. And it's a talk of the world today. And it's a multi-drug resistance, that's an issue. We too have two siblings here in our own department and with multi-drug resistant typhoid, two siblings. So I think the issue is that, and another thing which as clinician now we are observing is this is a pan-India problem that now it's taking very long time with the ceftriaxone for defervescence of typhoid fever 5 to 7 days. So they are this drug resistance is also increasing. So basically when somebody can afford, one should be using both these vaccine, and same is for HPV. HPV vaccine is one vaccine where efficacy is to the tune of 96%, which is not seen with other used vaccine, other live viral vaccines. So with these comments, we still have time. So if organizer permit, we can take a few important questions. And can I have the mic there? Yeah, please introduce yourself and you can just move on to the front side.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm Dr. Nilesh Kapoor, and I have worked with the WHO and USAID, and I was working with even Delhi government at one point of time. So just a couple of observations and a question. The first thing is Delhi government also has its own program on typhoid vaccine. It's part of their childhood sort of vaccination program. And Delhi government is also doing it from its own funds. Number two, During the whole discourse, we are always concentrated on the children. The whole government program is sort of focused on children. But especially with regard to certain diseases like typhoid, which has got a carrier stage also, which has got a huge adult cohort, which can sort of harbor the disease and sort of propagate it, I think the time is there. We should think about adult vaccination also as a conjunct to the childhood vaccination. Number three, the question part is that, do we have any evidence on the effect of the vaccine on the carrier state? Have we got anything on that?
Just to add on, this Navi Mumbai Municipal Corporation is also running one project. Ex-Indian President, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, Vijay Avalay's team is running this project, and this being supported by the government of Maharashtra on typhoid vaccine, like in Delhi.
That's true. And although there are trials on to look at whether there will be any effect on the carrier. So what is envisaged that it's going to actually affect the carrier stage also. This is what is envisaged in the clinic. However, the recommendations or the results are not yet available, whether they will be actually going to, because that is a very relevant point, because carriers keep on then circulating the bacteria in the community and leading to the outbreaks. So, however, conclusive evidence is not as yet available because of vaccines. Thank
you. Can you just tell what exactly is the method you are using in your trial, because you are the only,
That was for HPV vaccine. HPV vaccine. So this is a quadrivalent vaccine and phase 3 trial.
Excuse me for a moment. Actually, it's difficult to look for the exact incidence of the carrier, because we don't know the exact, as we all know, we are working in WHO also, we don't have this robust data from India. That's the biggest issue. And it's difficult to label a particular individual, because we don't have those diagnostic markers or serological marker that this particular individual is going to be a carrier or is a carrier. Secondly, we don't have, because this is not a large cohort, so we don't have the evidence that how this vaccine, because if you look into the data, this vaccine take up is good in the urban areas where most of the private practitioners who are immunizing, and because it's not part of the government schedule except in two places. So difficult to say. I think only time will tell that how this vaccine is going to impact the carrier state.
It is very difficult to detect typhoid carrier. So what are the criteria for detecting typhoid carrier? This is very, very too much problem. So tell me the sir.
Thank you for the very nice presentation. I'm Dr. Shatabdi, currently working as assistant professor from Kolkata. Sir, on behalf of from the state headquarter, we are also working with the NPCDCS. And in the NPCDCS, we are having the different kind of the interventions like NCD clinics and so on. But the HPV vaccine is not in least. We are also facing the several hurdles, whether to introduce in the state manner or not, and we are taking that what ma'am showed that paper that for the cost effectiveness. I like to ask you, ma'am, is it necessary at the state level to conduct the studies and to assess whether it is effective for the state or not? And one more thing that, ma'am, if a boy or girl, currently it is going to be introduced among the girls, if she misses the vaccine, by age of the 15 years, that is the last, then is there any option to give later on?
There are two questions. Actually, first I could gather that it is not necessary that state conduct its own studies. That is not necessary. There is a national level agency, the National Technical Advisory on Immunization. So this committee can recommend that it should be introduced by the state or at the national level. So if the state has budget, so they can do at their own level, because health is a state subject. State can decide for its own people. So that is one. And regarding second, like more than 15 years, you have to give more number of doses. It's not that the child, if you are immunizing the child less than 14 years of age, then two doses. And if you are the child, the age is more than 15 years, 15 to 25 years. Actually, the idea is before the sexual activity. So up till 25 years, if you think that there is no initiation of the sexual activity, the vaccine can be given and it will be effective.
You can give it up to 26 years of age. And prior to that, it is recommended to do screening if somebody has contact or carrying those viruses, because this multi-dose 9-valent still can be used. So then it becomes a tedious. You have to go for screening, but cutoff is 26 years. But ideally, if you want to have a 96% efficacy, then the age is, you should start from the 9 years, before 15 years in the adolescence. And for the data, it's now, registry data is available for all cancers. And secondly, for males, we are even lagging for immunization for females. So who is going to think of males in India? So I think that's the issue which our students will take on. So.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone, for the questions and the presenters for the answers. I have two comments to make because typhoid has been in the schedule and it was off, and again we are looking at getting back. There is also at the same time the antibiotic resistance, there is a reversal of resistance also. So the current typhoid is now sensitive to the conventional antibiotics. So the challenge is in both sides. Again, sir, Dr. Lalit is about influenza vaccination. Again, challenges are many, but I have a question for you. Recommend people who are visiting India should take influenza vaccine or not? There are now people are the, it affects tourism, it affects the revenue, it affects like death is as you told, it's the tip of iceberg. So morbidity and the economy is also now influenza is hitting the economy of a country. So what will be your recommendation if somebody is visiting? High-risk people should be.
They should continue. And then it's recommended for 60 and it's in geriatric population, it is recommended. So that is.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Influenza talks about.
Yeah. Dr. Madhu, again, just to supplement and through your question also, if it passes you, it stimulates you to carry on your study.
Yeah.
Nobody stops you. We are the advocates. Then, like as the house is now confident after Madhu's session on the question papilloma virus, now it is vaccine is 90% more than 90% efficacious. So you can advocate in your own state.
Yeah.
There are now lessons, success stories which are there in the country, and we had some issues in HPV. So if you are willing, you can advocate, but again, competing priorities are there. States have limited funds, whether it is cough etiquette, hand hygiene, or papilloma or influenza vaccine. You have a limited pie. So nobody stops you. Do research. Get more evidence. More evidence makes it more stronger. Tarun, you had a last question. I think Dr. Anupam will take a call on this.
Okay, we can take one question now. Because we are...
Loud enough.
I think it's high time that the association should fight to reduce the cost negotiating with the companies when the volume of users are there?
Actually, it's basically the northern and southern hemisphere. That's a different question. That vaccine is licensed because we don't have data from it's collected by the WHO, and then they share it with the manufacturer of the vaccine. And by the time of September, October, when the new strain is going to then this vaccine is launched. And regarding both quadrivalent and tetravalent, they are equally efficacious. But the issue with this vaccine is the different study, the vaccine efficacy is from 35% to 65% at the most. But the silver lining here is something is better than nothing. And there's a cross protection. So that's another advantage, because during this season, we don't have time here. We see patients of all types this time in the current season, when we had around 400 patients from this part only. And we have number of patients. With this, I'd like to thank the organizer and hand over to them. Thank you very much for your excellent interaction.
Okay, as we come to end of this session, we thank our chairpersons and speakers, and we would like to honor our speakers. I request Dr. Ashwini Sood to felicitate Dr. Lalit Sankhe. Sir, you can come on the stage. And Dr. Vinod Patro to honor Dr. Madhu Gupta. And I would like to take this opportunity to tell you all that Madhu is our oral alumnus, and she's a very good friend of mine, and she was 4 years junior to me in this college. And we are very proud of her that she has achieved great laurels.
Thank you, Dr.
And I would like to invite Dr. Sanjay Jodhpe to felicitate our chairpersons. Sir, if you don't mind. If you don't mind, to one of our chairpersons, please. Dr. Ashwini Sood, Professor and Head Department of Pediatrics, IGMC Shimla. Vinod Patro, Additional Professor, AIIMS, Bhubaneswar.
It's a pleasure, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, we can have a photo.
Oh, yeah.
With the speaker. Okay, thank you very much. Dr. Brigadier Sundarlal is one of the most eminent public health experts who has served as professor and head of social and preventive medicine at PGIMS Rohtak. He earned over 37 years of teaching and training and research experience in community medicine. And he was also honorary chief editor of Indian Journal of Community Medicine and secretary general of IAPSM for many years. He distinguished himself as a fellow of Indian Association of Preventive and Social Medicine. We welcome you, sir. Our next chairperson is Dr. Arun Kumar Agarwal. He is Professor, Department of Community Medicine, School of Public Health, PGIMR, Chandigarh. Besides other fields of interest, he has got keen interest in health system strengthening, and he's President of Association of Health System Analysis and Strengthening, and he has been organizing national workshops on health system strengthening since 2015.
He is chief editor of International Journal of Health Systems and Implementation Research also. We welcome you, sir, for this session, and I now hand over the mic to the chairpersons for conducting this session. Thank you, sir.
First of all, I will congratulate the organizers for starting the session dot on time. So this is good. This is the first achievement done. We are in time. And I think there is a lot of gap. Why there is a gap in rich and poor, if I say that, if you classify yourself as poor. So many benches are there in front. Why not move forward, or you want to move out after some time? I'm sure if you are interested in nutrition, this bench of five eminent people who will be speaking and sharing their experience will not let you move out of the hall. And as far as my attachment with this group is concerned, this is the most opportune moment for IAPSM, that all of us, they were aspiring that we should do something. We should work with the government. People should ask us. I mean, in the social media, there's a lot of talk about it. So this is that wonderful opportunity that has come our way through Alive and Thrive, which is an organization which is focused on nutrition, preventive and promotive aspects. But it has given a wonderful platform for IAPSM to prove its worth. And if I'm very sure under the leadership of Dr. Kadri, IAPSM will do wonders. But if we give very good results over here, then no one can stop us from having lot of projects and activities throughout the country. So this is a golden opportunity. Let us hear to the speakers. First of all, Dr. Shailesh Jagtap, who is Senior Technical and Program Advisor of Alive and Thrive, actually who had initiated all this concept through Alive and Thrive, and he roped in IAPSM. This was his idea of the organization, which he is implementing. He is the man behind actually involving IAPSM. So please brief us about what are your expectations from organization.
Thank you, sir, for inviting me to talk about this maternal infant young child nutrition and how medical college and overall Broadway IAPSM can take it forward. So just let me introduce you. I am Dr. Shailesh Jagtap. Though I represent Alive and Thrive today here, but still I am an IAPSM person. I have done my MD-PSM. So this has both you can say emotions through Alive and Thrive and as an IAPSM person. Okay. So the objective behind this IAPSM is, I know that we as an IAPSM has a potential, but that potential has not yet taken to a full fledged flight, you can say, as with other professional associates. So I think, as rightly said, so this is an opportunity and core area of IAPSM preventive area, an opportunity. Again, before going into the details of it, Alive and Thrive always believe in not only doing in small level activity, piloting or small activity, but how it can take it to a scale. And until and unless we take it to a scale, it will not create an impact. For an India country like India, small district, small block doing something and showing result will not lead to a change. Only taking to a scale, it may be a diffuse type of a implementation or whatever quality may affect, but still it will create a change. Coverage will lead to an impact, and plus later on quality. I will not go much into Alive and Thrive. So we work on maternal nutrition infant on all aspects of MYCIN service delivery, MYCIN delivery. We work through platforms like health platform, ICDS platform, self-help group platform, livelihood platform, because nutrition is a multi-sectoral and multi, you can say, stakeholder involvement, multi-strategic approach involvement component. So we, apart from this differentiation of health sector and different sector, Alive and Thrive it plays here as a knowledge partner, and we work at the policy level. If there are gaps in the policies, so we support the government in having those policies, guidelines, or on that? Maternal nutrition guidelines was not there. So I think few months or few next six months there will be a guideline on it. Similarly, we work at the implementation level through implementing partners. We are not an implementing partner, but we work with implementing partner, with the government system, be the professional association like IAPSM, IAP Foxy, and also with the other NGO implementing partners. Now, just a basic understanding for you all, what is the focus? In nutrition, there are many aspects of it, but then these are the key critical interventions that allow and thrive things. These are high impact and feasible interventions. Again, we use this model of impact and feasibility. What is the model? What is feasible and what is can create an impact across the 1,000-day spectrum period? I will not go into it, but you all know this. Maternal nutrition, diet diversity, one of the critical indicator. Then in child, early initiation of breastfeeding, exclusive breastfeeding, timely introduction of complementary feeding, and then continuation of breastfeeding and complementary feeding. Now, if you see the overall spectrum, who are the key stakeholders involved in this? See, if you see, there are different partners are there, private sector, government sector, ICDS, health, SAG, and medical college is one of the important player who can contribute into nutrition improvement. I will not go into why medical colleges, because we know that this is a core area of community medicine, not only community, but pediatric and gynae department. So this whole idea is about, first, medical college related work is about strengthening these systems, medical college institutions, so that we create a sustainable future workforce who can work on MYCIN related, maternal, infant, young child nutrition. Because we know taking any program and training our healthcare staff is a humongous task. And many times it just remains a training program. It does not take it, it does not go beyond training program and just that program gets abolished. But we need to take it to implementation. It needs to be implemented. So it is beyond training. It's not just only training. Systems training approach. So what are the different components? When we talk about medical college, so what are the different things that medical college does? They are academicians. So the undergraduate curriculum or the postgraduate curriculum should incorporate or should talk about this maternal, infant, young child nutrition. Then as a hospital, tertiary care hospital, service delivery need to be improved. Service delivery across different contact points around this 1,000-day period. And coming in mothers and family members coming in contact with the pediatric department, gynae department, and community medicine department. So these are the core functioning of the medical college. But beyond that, medical college as a knowledge partner, medical college as a advisor can play a bigger role also improving the other public health system program, public health and ICDS, and how it can be done. So here, community medicine has a bigger role. Other department also has a role in terms of capacity building of the other health workforce, public health workforce, ICDS workforce. But community medicine can play a role in bringing evidence. Yes, this program can be implemented. Providing supportive supervision related activities and working with the government system through advocacy. So just I will not just go into detail, but just to brief you that when we did a baseline study and some findings, we found out that there is a still gap in the knowledge among the students, among the service providers, among the faculty related to maternal, infant, young child nutrition. Very basic thing, this is a very basic thing, but still there are knowledge gap. And it's just not knowledge gap, but there are service delivery gaps also. Nursing staff are not able to provide counseling on breastfeeding, not able to provide, just talking about diet diversity, not talking about the problems related to IFA, why mother is not able to take iron folic acid. It's not just about giving iron folic acid, but supporting mother to take iron folic acid because of other side effect or other problems. So with this understanding, how this can be taken forward. So we had a consultation with the medical college, all the staff, students, PG students, nursing staff, and sort of a visioning exercise came out. In that visioning exercise, consultative process, lot of operational issues came out, which actually were not prescribed by us, but that came out from the medical college themselves. Like having a cross-departmental nutrition cell or an interdepartmental coordination committee between these three departments, pediatric, gynae, and community medicine department, then having resource materials available with them, then having a dedicated professor for nutrition with the community medicine department. So there are a lot of many things came out from those visioning exercises. Having a lactation management center in a pediatric department, we call a human milk bank. And obviously now government has already come out with that guidelines on lactation management. So these came out from the medical college itself. So that was heartening to see that there. But the issue was these were bits and pieces, but not a structured way. So we tried to structure this whole vision of the medical college on a priority basis. Like we said, on a priority basis, so we started working on the three components. One is the service delivery, curriculum integration in the undergraduate student curriculum, then service delivery improvement and supportive supervision and research. How in research, focusing on implementation research, operational research, bringing evidences of success or failure. Failure also doesn't mean that our research is faulty. Whatever the failures, recommendations will also be useful for implementation. So for this, I will just take you quickly through the process that we adopted. We formed a technical expert committee involving the all the faculties from these three departments, from different medical colleges in UP, Bihar, separate for UP, Bihar, and plus national level faculty. And these committee consulted through a series of meetings, workshops, and then came out with four documents. Two for the curriculum, one was the reference document for a student and for the faculty, which was on the technical aspect of it. And the second part was on the operational aspect of curriculum. How this curriculum should look into and what are the different aspects that need to be included into the teaching and learning program. That, okay, document is there. But when we want to roll it out, so we need the medical college to own it up. So ownership buying from the medical college needed, and so they themselves form a interdepartmental coordination committee at the medical college level. Three departments together form their own one nodal person and a committee, and they are taking it forward how they can work on these different aspects. So now I will talk, just take you through quickly through a service delivery. Do you know what is this? This is a opportunity for providing maternal infant junctional nutrition related services. ANCOPD, when a pregnant woman comes to ANCOPD, doctors, does they do assessment of nutritional status of mothers? Or whether they give key messages or counseling related nutrition? No, this is not happening universally. Because this conference theme is universal healthcare. So universalization is a key word. Only, please let me know any time. I will take just three minutes. Okay. So we developed a 9 protocols across the different contact points. Protocols we are talking about when a mother enters an OPD, what does nurse has to do, then from nurse, whether when the patient goes to doctor or PG student, what that doctor has to do, from the doctor again to the nurse, what she has to reiterate there, from there to the counselor or to the laboratory. So in that algorithm manner, we developed those protocols for across these different contact points. So I will not brief you on this, but just quickly show you how this protocol looks about. So this is just a quick glance for a logical flow of how this patient flows, and at each point, each interaction, what are the key messages, what are the services that need to be provided. In postnatal care ward, what nursing staff has to do in during discharge, what nursing staff or the PG student or a doctor need to do. So across all the contact points, immunization OPD, be the pediatric OPD or the SNCU, at each contact point, everyone if starts talking on the nutrition related issues and key messages, it will lead to a change. Because mothers are confused if a doctor says something and if a nurse says something. So standardization and same messaging is important. This is a behavioral change component. Curriculum, I will not go into detail of it curriculum, but still just show you what this curriculum is comprising of. This is a summary. This is for maternal nutrition. This talks about different topics and different lectures spread across the undergraduate curriculum period from third semester to eighth semester. Some are in the lecture form, some are in the practical, OPD, some are in the ward, and how they can be taught to the students and how they need to be assessed. Assessment is important. So this curriculum talks about these all aspects of teaching and learning program. Now, as a community medicine person or as IAPSM, what are the key roles that we expect? That IAPSM need to advocate that these competency-based curriculum need to be adopted by every medical college, advocate, and take a build a capacity. Wherever IAPSM pediatric or gynae department are not taking initiative, IAPSM or the community department can coordinate those meetings. So this is just, it's not only one department, but role of all the three department, and community medicine department can play a key role in coordinating this and advocating. Another important aspect is research. See, we as a community medicine or a preventive social medicine person, also we talk about research survey, but we need to move from just KAP studies to implementation research and be one of the important key player in providing evidence to the program planners and the implementers. This is how it need to be done. This is what need to be the policy, and this is how the government should run the program. So I will not go into it. So there are different components. There is another separate session on that, separate lecture on it. So PG thesis. So we have opportunity in terms of PG thesis, whatever survey that has been done, how it can be see that it goes into the implementation and with focus on MYCIN. And for this to happen, it's not just at the medical college. Sometimes we need to be proactive and take a step towards having a linkage with the government system, because the resources required will come from government. They have it, but then they are not able to utilize it. So on this research front, we are doing piloting this research activity and supportive supervision activity in two medical colleges, one in UP and one in Bihar. So some detail about it, they'll be there in next speaker's presentation. But still, to give a snapshot of it, what is there in the supportive supervision, we need to see what is the healthcare frontline workers are providing, assessment of those service providers, trying to identify bottlenecks, why they are not able to deliver or provide those services. It's not just identifying gaps, but identifying bottlenecks and then identifying solutions and helping the system to implement those solutions. And second level of assessment is at the supervisory level. It may be the supervisor or their program manager or a decision maker. So that assessment also can be done. And that assessment through qualitative tool checklist will definitely help us in identifying the problems and identifying solutions. So this whole aspect of supportive supervision and implement research is to find solutions and help the government system to implement those. And last component that we are supporting, like, it's very technical, but still a partner like PATH, we are with engaging, partnering with PATH organization. We are supporting whoever are interested or fill the criteria in supporting having a human milk bank or a lactation management center in those medical colleges. This will be with the pediatric department, but still we have a role in having this comprehensive component in a medical college. We, as IAPSM, we can advocate, support, help in including them into the PIP. Budget is there. Government is saying we have budget. Ministry is saying we have a state is saying budget. But still, they are not able to put money for this because nobody is guiding them or supporting them or nobody is demanding. So last slide, what are the components? So broad area, if you see, as an IAPSM, need to take it forward. We are looking towards IAPSM as a, like, 420 plus members in 420 plus medical college, and around 5,000 members are there. So across each medical college, we have members from IAPSM. So if even one person from each medical is motivated, so they can take it this to all medical almost, you can say literally. So how they can take a scale? Moving from research, normal CAP study to research. Whatever resource capacity building is required, definitely that can be identified from Alive and Thrive, or already there are so much resources. We have a person like Dr. Arun Agarwal, sir, and there are many others there who are involved into this capacity system. So I think, thank you.
Thank you, great.
welcome Dr. Anjali Chauhan also, and she is also one of the co-chairs for this session. She is a program officer in National Health Mission, and she is looking after IEC cell.
Great.
So she's there.
Any chair?
Okay, we'll give her a chair, but okay. Okay. She's comfortable there only, sir.
Okay. I think, yeah, there is no question answer at this stage. But I will request now to the next speakers to alter their presentations in such a way that average 8 minutes are available now. And at the same time, backup arrangement for the last speaker, think in mind that if he or she is required to do in 2-3 minutes. Okay. So next is So Dr. Pragati Chapda, she is Director Professor UCMS Delhi, and subjects of interest are nutrition, maternal and child health, epidemiology of NCD, and more than 50 publications are there, and many books, chapters she has written, and reviewer to many reputed journals, and now she is one of the very, very...
So we have to address it. Similarly, as we see globally, that nutrition is just there. It's nobody's baby. Similarly, in medical education, it is being talked about. It is touched about. We say, yeah, we will talk of nutrition. But it is never taken seriously by any of us. So there is a dire need to incorporate this more seriously in our medical education. How can we do it? We can do it at all levels, right? At all levels of prevention when we talk. That is from health promotion and protection, early detection of nutritional problems. Then, of course, we have to manage undernutrition and overnutrition. And also, nutrition is a very important part of every disease during illness as well as convalescence. So in all these aspects, we need to strengthen our nutrition component. Now, when we talk of anything in undergrad nutrition, we have to see MCI. They are the ones which will determine what our medical graduate has to learn. And as it says, the MCI says that graduate has to be have these requisite skills, that is knowledge, skills, attitudes, values, and responsiveness, so that he can function as a first contact physician. So are we doing it? And this advocate that we have to have the preventive, promotive, curative aspect, and also health and community nutrition orientation. In this, the nutrition would also become very important. And they advocate self-learning and importance of social factors. And we all know that social factors are very important in nutrition. And also active use of demonstration of methods is needed, which we will see is lacking, and first-hand experience, and learning in small groups and integrated teaching. This is what has been advocated as goals by the MCI. And we all know that recently, even in one of the sessions in the morning, we talked about the competency-based undergrad curriculum in the Indian medical graduate that came in 2018. And for the first time, we are talking of competencies, outcomes. And this is a very good sign. And for each subject, they have suggested certain competencies, and there are various domains. You all know that we are teachers. We talk about knowledge, skill, attitude, and communication. And they have expected level of achievement for each. That is, the student is supposed to know certain outcomes, know how certain outcomes, show certain outcomes, and show how and perform. So this is you all, most of you must be familiar with this. So I thought, let's see, how is nutrition faring? We all know that nutrition is taught right from preclinical, para, and then in the clinical fields, in biochemistry, physiology, our subject, medicine, pediatrics, and obstetrics. And some part in pathology is also covered. If you look at our subject in community medicine, we just have 20 topics, and number of outcomes are 107. So we feel this is markedly less than what it should be. And we talk of nutrition. Here I'm not talking of MYCIN, because they're just talking of general nutrition. It is just 8 competency. And sadly, only 2 are skill-based. That is, DOAP stands for demonstrate, observe, assist, and perform. So we see that only the student is expected to perform a nutritional assessment and of the families in the community, and also recommend a suitable diet for the individuals and family. So these are the only ones which are skill-based. So that is what I think it should not be. I think every aspect in nutrition should be skill-based. And there are just 8 competencies, and the other 6 are only knowledge-based. That is, they would be just involving lecture or maybe a small group discussion. So they don't talk of, you know, that we develop skills for student in these fields. Like say nutrition requirements, so we could have a diet demonstration, that is not being said. And then also about nutritional related health disorder. We are talking of so many nutritional problems in the community, but they don't talk of any skill-based program in that. Similarly, nutritional surveillance and education is being stressed on. Then they also mention about national nutrition policy and programs. Then there is a one competency based on food hygiene, and the others on food fortification and effects of additives. And they have been integrated with pediatrics, general medicine, and microbiology. Now I would like to talk of the other subjects. When we talk of nutritional pediatrics, it takes a cake in nutrition education. They have more than 80 outcomes. A total of 400 plus have been given to pediatrics with normal growth and development 7 and breastfeeding. Here, there are 11 outcomes for that. And I would like to point out this August house that even subjects like awareness of cultural beliefs and practices of breastfeeding and educating mothers on antenatal breast care and preparing mothers for lactation have been, you know, given to pediatrics. And they don't even integrate it with community medicine. So this is something I think we as a, you know, group have to call for. That it can't be that, because we always thought breastfeeding was our baby. We have trained in IYCF and this thing. But in this curriculum, there is no mention of breastfeeding in our subject. Complementary feeding, again, it's with pediatrics, where we are just to integrate with them. Similarly, normal nutrition assessment monitoring is 7 outcomes. Then about providing nutritional support, assessment, monitoring of nutritional problems is 6. And obesity is another topic, 6. Then we have micronutrients in health and disease. That is about a large number they've been given. That adds up to 35. And then the natural health programs also, we are just integrating. So it's sad that we have been made to pay a second fiddle in nutrition. So this is something I think we as IAPSM and we being representing the MYCIN group, we should take up this with the MCI. Similarly, medicine has got anemia, vitamin deficiency, obesity, etc. And there we are to integrate with certain subjects. So I will not take time. So I've done a little SWOT analysis. What I feel, everything is not bleak. I will count this curriculum as strength, that at least they have talked about nutrition-related outcomes. Of course, we don't have it, but we can strive to have it. Similarly, we have a faculty which is committed. They have enough knowledge. Some need more training. And we have the national guidelines in place, like on RDA, IYCF, iron, etc. Of course, there are certain weaknesses, like there is a lack of infrastructure and resources, which can always, you know, innovate and improve. Then another weakness we all see is summative assessment at the end of 7th semester. When the student is not so much aware of the clinical path, so that also I think we can work upon. And there are enough opportunities. We have postings with them in the 3rd, 4th, and 6th semester, which we have to make use of. Nutritional assessment, diet survey, etc. And again, the threats, like the student reads what he has to be assessed on. Agar exam mein nahi aayega, wo padega nahi. To hume aisa assessment banana hai, jisse wo bacha, matlab usko important samjhe. And of course, we all know that we don't. When I'm an undergraduate, I'm worried about my post-graduation. And that is all MCQ-based. So if I don't have an MCQ on undergraduation, he's not interested. So these are the threats. So I will leave the house with these challenges what we have. Integration is all very good on paper, we know that. But on real life, it's so difficult. So we have to think of actual ways to integrate. So vertical and horizontal is very beautiful. But we've seen the experience of IMNCI. How, what happened? Pediatrics apna padha rahe the, hum apna. So that these are the practical questions we have to address. And small group teaching with an increased number of students always remains a problem. There's a problem of time, space. Then of course skills, counseling, we all know. There's a training for so many months, dietary advice. So we have to address those things. And of course teachers ourselves, we have to be, you know, trained in these skills. And there are recent advances. Like I talked in my first slide about this thing, syndemic. You know, nutrition is a very complex subject. What do we take? All that things have to be worked upon. So I think we, as the members of IAPSM, will take this forward, this teaching. And thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Pragati, for bringing out nicely the challenges. For request my co-chair, Dr. Anjali. Anjali.
So I would like to invite Dr. Rambha Pathak, who is the head of the Department of Community Medicine. She's got 55 publications in the Index Journal, and she's a member of MYCIN, and also member of State Task Force of RNTCP. And she would be presenting on, can community medicine department play a bigger role in Poshan Abhiyan through regular supportive supervision, mentoring, and review of NASHU?
Thank you, ma'am. At the outset, I would like to thank organizers for providing me this extent. But over here, what we want as IAPSM, MYCN group, we basically want that the emphasis should be on maternal, infant, and young child nutrition. And we want that all medical colleges should come forward. Government of India is planning to have medical college in each district. So in each district, there will be a community medicine department. And that department can take up this responsibility of carrying out supporting supervision of a problem which is such a big underlying cause of most of the health problems that we are having in our country. So over here, we are trying to see how can we do it, because we need to have a roadmap. If we take up this responsibility, we should have some resources, some facilities in order to carry it out. So how to do it? So my presentation today is role of community medicine department in carrying out supportive supervision. Now, what is supportive supervision? This we have to understand. Because till now, we understand that supervision means control supervision. We will go do inspection and come back and give our report. Supportive supervision is a process where we have to be respectful and non-authoritarian. That is very important. And it is an open two-way communication with a team approach where we have to take frontline worker and whoever we are supervising, we have to take them in confidence, ask them where the problem is, and then try to find out a solution. Now, what are the objectives of supportive supervision? Now, for our department, because we all know there are so many things, for our department, we would like to see what is the benefit we are getting out of this. Because we have another mandate, we have mandate of teaching and training the students. So the benefit that we will get from this is, we will get an opportunity for experiential learning. This is learning by doing. We will be posting our postgraduates, our senior resident, our young faculty. They will be going to field, they will be carrying it out. So the task that they are supposed to do in future, they will be doing it while having their course, while having their education, they will be learning this. So this will be beneficial and we will all be benefited by it. Then second, this will also help government in improving the program. Basically, when we have opted for medical education, for health, then we are definitely trying to improve the programs that we are having in our country to benefit people, population. So it will also ensure data quality, identify implementation gaps, and then it will also validate and harmonize data. Because it is not that supportive supervision is not being done by the program. If we look at the program, every program has their inbuilt supportive supervision system. Then what are we trying to do? we are trying to see, validate and harmonize that reported data which is coming. So our duty will be, our responsibility will be to go and validate that and to see how good or how well that data is being collected, and we will improve health staff skill, and this will also help us gather suggestions to improve the processes. Now for doing this, there are certain prerequisites. We need to have right supervisors, right tools, and right resources. Right supervisors, what does that mean? It means that we will have to reorient our staff. We should not just assume that we all know, we have read it in textbook, and we know how it is to be done. For that, we need to reorient our staff. We have to tell them, we have to teach them the techniques, the participatory approach, whatever newer information, because every day we hear, we are going to have a new program. So what are the newer programs which have come up? We need to tell our faculty, our students, everything. We have to update that information, and then we have to tell them how to identify problem and how to solve it. So a refresher training is needed. Then right tools need to be developed. I'm not saying that we have to reinvent the wheel. Whatever is available, from that we have to tailor it to our need and to see that from that we should be able to have a right tool, standardized tool, which can be used by all medical colleges to carry it out. And this tool should be short, specific, and simple. Then for this, we also need resources. For that, we need vehicle, we need paradigm, because the in district, maybe there are rural areas, they may have to go to remote areas for that, driver, fuel, all these things are also needed, and even time is needed, because other than studies, other than teaching, we'll have to go and do this work too. So this is the process of supportive supervision. I'll just skip that. Let's see where we will have to take this task first. For carrying it out, we will have to decide the priority area. And the priority area will be the one which is having highest number of malnourished children. We have data already available. From data, we can make out which district is not performing good. So from there, we can take the priority area, and we will be conducting our supervisory visit there first. Then, when is it to be done? Is it to be done during fixed site, outreach, mobile session? So we have to see to it that we are covering routine as well as mobile sessions. Everything needs to be covered in that super supportive supervision, and the health worker whom we are going to visit, they should be informed. Whenever we make our calendar, we should see what work plan they have already prepared, and this should be on the basis of this, on that. And at least two visits per year should be made to each health facility. And what subjects, what is to be seen, that should be decided prior to making the visit. Then, while conducting supportive supervision, these are the steps that we have to take. We have to collect information. We have to solve the problems, identify and solve problem, and then we have to also provide on-job training, because you must have seen under Poshan Abhiyan, they are talking about incremental learning approach. So what is this ILA approach? In that, the role of supervisor is that they will provide on-job training. Whenever they will see that the worker, frontline worker, is not doing that work well, they will support and they will provide training. Then this is to be recorded and sent to all the stakeholders, and in the end, there should be follow-up. So for collecting information, we will be observing the health facility, and by listening to worker, by reviewing the records, we will be collecting data. Then even beneficiaries, they also need to be interacted with and collected data from. Then the problem is identified, and when you identify the problem, you have to basically try to see, tackle one problem at a time, and then the problem which can have easy solution. Because when we go in field, we see that there are things which can be easily solved. There are problems which are actually at the level of training or at the level, so that can be solved by the supervisor itself, the person who is going for it. So on the job training actually involves these steps, which we can discuss. You can see here that first of all, when you are providing on-job training, we have to explain them, we have to demonstrate, then we have to ask them to show us, they have to practice in front of us, and then finally it is to be reviewed whether they have learned it or not. Then this is to be recorded. Now, about recording, there are certain things which we should be very careful. We have to first of all write down who is being supervised, then list the tasks and responsibilities and how well that person has done these tasks. Then we have to assess overall performance. It should not be only that, it should be attendance, punctuality, spirit of initiative, creativity, capacity to work independently. These are also some of the parameters which we should take care of. Then mention what immediate corrective action has been taken, and then how we have to basically share it with the supervisee as well as all the stakeholders. Then only it will be effective. And it should not be just one-time activity. It is something which should be done on a regular basis, and follow-up also needs to be done. So this is all about supportive supervision that is basically done. So if we see it, to summarize, this is the chart that is there. We will have to first of all identify districts, then prioritize indicators, advocate it with the government, because then only we will get the required support, organize orientation workshop, then visit the health facility, provide on-job orientation, collect data, prepare report, send it, disseminate it wherever it is needed, and then prepare improvement action plan. So it is basically a cyclical thing which should be done at periodic interval. Thank you.
Great.
Very good.
Maybe we have some discussions.
First of all, as we are in Shimla, so I asked Master Sir, thank Sir for telling me this. So सबसे पहले मैं start करूँगा इससे सभी गणमान्य व्यक्तियों को ढाल करूँ and जयकार. CAP study is a topic that is, I don't have a PowerPoint, so if you are thinking about it, I'm sorry. I avoid PowerPoints as much as possible.
You have a lot of power in you.
I avoid PowerPoints because I think it distracts me at times. So the topic, I will repeat, is from CAP studies to implementation research. It's nothing new. Implementation research was done by community medicine. Some of the pioneers are our chairpersons here, Dr. Sundar Lal, Dr. Arun Agarwal, and other people. There are many other people in the August audience who are focusing on this. And it has been tried in various ways in different platforms. Like immunization also, it was being done, some people were doing. Now in maternal, infant, and young child nutrition, so we already know why implementation research is needed. So because we have very good policies in our documents, foolproof policies, but what happens when they are implemented? They all fail at different levels. And we come out after 5 years, after 10 years. Ye program to chale hi nahi. Itna achha program banaya tha. Iski galti hai, iski galti, ye nahi karta, wo nahi karta. All these things happen. The problem is that, so the idea is that implementation research is actually needed. It's a type, or we say a different type, but related to operational research also. So implementation jab karke dekhen, to usme kya problems aa rahi hai? Just having a policy or a program on paper and thinking that it will translate into reality just as it is, it will not happen. So implementation research is important. Now, I will not tell about what are the definition of implementation research, steps of implementation result. Today I will just like to focus on how to start with implementation research, one. Secondly, how we in MYCIN IAPSM National Working Group that has been formed, how we will try to take implementation research forward, the first step that we are going to take in this. So as you all know that, as ma'am talked about, Dr. Ramba Patak, about the supportive supervision that we are planning to do in the coming 1 year, along with the guidance of Dr. Arun Agarwal sir, that in two districts we will be doing, one in UP and one in Bihar, supportive supervision related to National Nutrition Mission, all the different steps, health and nutrition platform like ICDS. So on these two platforms we will be working, providing supportive supervision, and we will be identifying what are the problems that are there at those levels. And those problems will be converted into research questions, and that will form the basis of our implementation research. That will be the next step. So I'll just repeat it, identifying the problems at those levels, when we do supportive supervision, many problems will come out. and then we will take it out, and then we will try to see how they can be converted into implementation research questions. So implementation research actually, or any research, starts with a research question. If your research question is not an implementation research question, then that research question will not give you that kind of answer. So how to generate it? Usually when we do research, or thesis work is like every year we have to do, what we do is we try to find the research questions on the internet. We search some journals, some new words catch our fancy, or we think we can do it again here, and then we allot that type of thesis, that type of research in projects and other places. And most of the, not everyone, but many times we see that this is how it is being done. And some people even try to do implementation research, but they don't have the research questions, because they don't have exposure to the programs directly with the government functioning or the community level as such. So what we try to do is, in this project when we are doing, all those research questions, all the problems, when we do supervision, when they will come out, will convert into research questions, and we will put it on IAPSM website. So that implementation research questions are there. Any community medicine person anywhere in India, in a community medicine department, outside community medicine department, they want to do a project, there will be implementation research questions on that website, and you all can select a thing and do it in your own area if you think that is feasible, that is relevant in your area, in your geopolitical social context. So that is one aspect, important aspect, that we are going to do this implementation research. And the second part will be the capacity building. So second part will be MYCIN and IAPSM will try to see how we can do implementation research workshops where capacity building of the faculty members regarding that can be done. So today, as I stand here, I would like to request and appeal that all those who are interested in nutrition, specifically mother and infant young child nutrition, this plenary session is actually a platform to sensitize that such a national working group has been formed under this IAPSM group. And we want that we all can work together in different fields. There are many other sectors that we are working on, but that is not for this talk. So please communicate with us, contact us, and we are here to tell you that we exist and we can help, and you can help us, that we all can grow together and try to do some implementation research and show it at the ground level, what are the bottlenecks, how it can be solved, and then maybe we can scale it up. And then our relevance in the community, our importance with the policymakers, we think will improve. So with that, I would like to end, and I would like to thank the two medical colleges, AIIMS Patna, under the leadership of Dr. Neeraj Agarwal, and other faculty members, Dr. C.M. Singh, Dr. Sanjay Pandey, Dr. Pragya, and in Kannauj Medical College, Dr. Dinesh Martolia, and Dr. Tanu Bheda, and Dr. Pradeep Kharia from the adjacent college. So these are working at the first supportive supervision in the two districts, but we want more partners so that we can grow at a large scale, and definitely we'll try to scale it up. The newsletter that you have got is also one of the ways to disseminate that, to get in touch, and so that people know about this working group also. So thank you very much. I think I'm well in time.
Yes, yes, no
problem. So thank you. Thank you very much. I would not like to extend.
Thank you very much.
Medical curriculum, and then second part, service delivery protocol. Whatever is being done in the hospital, at district level, in the medical college, or wherever, the services are being provided. So we are also working on service delivery. That is what Dr. Shailesh was basically trying to say. They are knowledge partner, and they are trying to get it done through medical colleges. So medical colleges have to come forward. They have to participate. They have to basically roll out the medical curriculum that we have prepared, and then even the service delivery protocol which he was showing here, that needs to be implemented in the medical college. And supportive supervision is the third component of it, which we are trying in UP and Bihar at present, but we want other states also to come forward and work on it.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for adding that.
Great.
So, last one.
Yeah,
sorry, aapko khada hona pad raha
hai. So, I would like to now invite.
Presentation, but fortunately I have company of Dr. Amir, so I feel that I am not lonely in the on the planet. So, the presentation. So, in fact, when we have gone through the entire plenary session, I will be saying that already need and challenges are highlighted in the previous all the lectures. So now, instead of that, in fact, we have to think about how to move forward, how to actually realize this need, whatever the needs are, and overcome these challenges to actually realize at the medical level. That is the expectation, what I believe from me. And when I'm going through this entire session, I feel that I'm a bit innocent person. I have innocently given the consent to the MYCN group that I will be the plenary in the plenary session. But later on, I realized that it is the conspiracy against me, and not only against me, but also because IAPSM. And when I'm talking about the IAPSM, it means that not the IAPSM Secretary General, but IAPSM member also. But that is the good conspiracy, I would be saying. Conspiracy, it means that they have forced me to speak, they forced me to listen, and they forced me to commit. Not only me, it means that me and the medical colleges, because I am representing you only. So I think it is a very pleasant and a sweet conspiracy, I would be saying. But already it's highlighted that what is the role of the IAPSM, I would be saying, in this particularly meet the need and challenges. Already, Dr. Amir Maruf has said that as an IAPSM, we are doing something, activities. And as the title of this plenary session was saying, that some opportunities are we have missed at the medical college level, community medicine department, and that is they have highlighted. And that we have to together to think about that. Because previously we were thinking that the immunization is one of the considered as an important weapon, missile against the, for the preventive medicine. We are thinking that. But for unfortunately, that missile is hijacked by some other department. It is not necessary that it is the wrong thing or a bad thing, but now nutrition is the area still which is left out, where is still that area we can work upon and can establish our worth as a community medicine expert in. So that missed opportunity when the title they have written, I think that is the really, really written the title of the plenary session, that we have missed opportunity. But at the end, when we are concluding the plenary session, it should be the actually we have to meet the opportunity instead of the miss, that we have to convert our session. And as a part of it, as an IAPSM, we have formed the MYCN group. And as little bit activities we have carried out as a part of the MYCN group, you have seen that certain activities we have carried out. And not we have carried out as a MYCN because Alive and Thrive, Silas is the bridge person who is the of the some time point of the time is the our IAPSM member, sometime Alive Thrive member is the member. Not because they are supporting, but because nutrition is the area that we have to work on. As clearly highlighted in Madam Pragati's presentation, that there are at every level of the prevention, nutrition has the role to play. And definitely that role we have to, definitely that preventive and promotive activities, we can grab the opportunity and we have to carry out. So, and they have highlighted where these are the scopes are also there. And that is definitely medical curriculum or teaching and training areas, service delivery, and of course the implementing research. These are three important areas that we have to work on. So we are already having the supportive supervision types of the implementing research activities that already highlighted. Besides that, I would be saying that as an IAPSM, we have given the nutrition utmost importance. If you will go through our textbook, which is released today only, you will be seeing that second chapter of the textbook is on the nutrition. Because we believe that if we have to talk about the health, definitely nutrition comes first. Immunization comes later on. In the second section or third section, we'll be saying that. If we have to promote the health, because health promotion comes first, then comes the specific protection. And that's why, in fact, we have divided, kept the health nutrition as an important part of the immediate second chapter after the health, defining the health and disease. And in that part, we have also included MYCN, because when it comes to the nutrition, definitely nutrition starts from the actually mother. Not we'll be saying the woman, but mother, and to the ultimately, that's 1,000 days, important 1,000 days. So definitely we have included as a part of the our textbook as well. So students, so that is as a part of one commitment of as IAPSM and community medicine fraternity, we have included it into it. Now that is not the, this should not be the actually the end. It should be the real, the first step towards the our destination. Now comes, coming to the curriculum part. I think as a community medicine, I said that we should take up this opportunity as a team, not this MYCN group or IACM, but as all together our community medicine department. And we should have, now because in the newer competency-based curriculum of the this MCI is there, and there are lots of opportunity. This MYCN curriculum prepared by the group is based on the, in the alignment with the this newer competency-based curriculum. One thing is that, and it has got, they have recommended lots of opportunity, or the, in fact, as a strategy, integrated teaching. So, and nutrition is the one of the important area where, in way of integrated teaching, we can include with the support of the pediatric department and the gynec department. So I think that opportunity we also grabbed, already very well highlighted in the presentation, so need not to be, but I'm adding one component is that okay, additional opportunities also there that we have to grab. So that challenge of the integrating the is now overtaken, because it is now as compulsory to be implemented as per the MCI mandate. So that challenge is, I think, previously that we were speaking, some other department is speaking somewhere. So that opportunity we have to grab it, and we have to overcome that challenge also. Second, in the service delivery, one is the supportive supervision is the very good thing. And we are thinking that based on this, our experience of the two districts, we'll be expanding it in the other districts also. We are looking forward. Committed colleges and department who are interested can also later on join based on the field need and the interest and the competency of the department will be scaling up. So that is the one area. But besides this, there is two opportunities are there in the medical college itself. One is there our UHGC and RHGC area. So community nutrition is the one of the big area along with nutrition. In the community nutrition, definitely our target groups are the mother and the child. So there are the two areas, and we have got the paramedicals, health educators, as per the Medical Council of India, we have got that health people who are health, our para, like what is the nurse with the surgery and the medicine department, we have got the paramedics for the health promotional activities. We have stuck somewhere up to, from faculty professor to the resident. Beyond resident, we have never tapped the opportunity of the available forces, that is the medical social worker and the, not on the all the colleges, but at a number of the colleges, what I have observed that we have not tapped the potentiality of the social workers and the health educator available in the department for the health, for promotion of the health education. It means the promotion of the, in this case, particular nutrition. That opportunity also we have to take. And the UHSC, RHSC, our area, where in fact nobody is the rival. In fact, we are complementing the sales services. When we are entering the hospital, it might happen that some administrative wheel and mechanism should be there, so that integrator mechanism is there. So that opportunity also UHSC, RHSC area, we should also include a tap. And second is definitely in the hospital also, we have to include the, have the some says, area, fixed area or the integrated way where we can promote the MYCN. How that we have to think about. But again, I will be specifically saying that not only the resident, we have to use the social worker and the thing. Because many times what happens that I was specifically saying that when we are using the resident doctor or something, the people are saying that we are the health educators. Or many times we are using the statistician, the people are saying that we are statisticians. Actually, they are the supportive departments. Statistician is the supportive, like what is the for the nursing department, for the surgeon or the physician. Similarly, we are statistics and the health educators are there, and we have to take the help of like nursing care, in the medical care, nursing care is supporting. Similarly, the social worker care should be use it and have the mechanism, etc. Because that then it will be sustained. Otherwise, using the resident will not be the sustainable model otherwise. So resident will come because as a part of their exposure, they will be learning that part and they will go away. But that health worker, social worker and the health educator, as per the MCI norm, they are there. If they will be utilized, these three places, definitely that what we are presently finding that we could not have such types of the create the service outlets or the health for the MYCN or some other activities that can be carried out. So that is the one opportunity as an I am seeing. And as an IAPSM, I am thinking that we will be facilitating for using this opportunity in the coming days, because now MYCN gradually they are now consolidating themselves, they are growing up, and lots of good activities they are carrying out. So with this our MYCN committee, I wish that will be become the working group, will become the MYCN chapter later on, sub chapter of the IAPSM. And the way they are steadily moving ahead, I think slowly and steady, but definitely will be very soon have the MYCN chapter. But my thing in this MYCN chapter, we are having other initiatives like other implementing research also we are planning. Along with that, we are also have the courses to support the medical colleges to realize the missed opportunity, to meet the opportunity, convert it into the meeting the opportunity. And also we'll be having our, in the website also, we will have the dedicated pages MYCN where people can have the information sharing of the MYCN, because presently we are having the biannually this newsletter, but now we with the website, web media we'll be having that one page, but along with one page, different other pages will be there where we can share the and promote the MYCN. So as an IAPSM, we'll be carrying out these activities to promote this idea and help the medical colleges to realize, overcome these challenges and to realize the MYCN. Thank you very much. So I completed 8 hours over.
Thank you,
sir.
In this, you know, I'm actually representing the. So as I'm representing the government department here, because I'm working as a program officer, it is very, I was really happy to see that the Department of PSM, you know, the faculties of the medical colleges are also trying to bring some kind of coordination with the people working in the field and the medical colleges. Because if I talk about my state, when I was in PGI, I was doing my public health specialization. I could see PGI has a very important and a vital role, and it works with the state government of Haryana and Punjab. But coming back to my state, we do not have that active participation of the medical colleges here. Just touching one topic of supportive supervision, if I talk about the state, one program officer at the state level has to look after 4 to 6 programs. That is a huge burden on the program officer. Similar things happen at the district level. So ultimately, it is just, you know, implementing what are the guidelines in the paper into the field. But regarding the supervision, definitely, we really lack there. And I think that is the reason why many of the programs or the strategies of the government fails. So if the Department of PSM, they come actively and, you know, they assess us, that would be a great thing, a great opportunity for us to improve as well, because they have a whole fleet of students. Even I would say they can even involve the undergraduate, the final years into it, because they will first of all have a hands-on experience, what is actually going on in the field, what that program really is. They will come out of the books and realize in the field that what it is. And also they have the postgraduates, they have the senior residents, because we have a system of supervision in the system as well. Like we have ASHA workers who are supervised by health workers. Health workers are supervised by supervisors. So it's not really going to the ASHA workers, but supervising our supervisors. So that would be a great initiative. And it's a really good thought that has come up here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anjali, for valuable comments. Friends, nutrition is not new to this group. And we have stalwart Professor Sundarlal, who has spent his life on these issues. Now I request him to share a few words of wisdom to this new upcoming group now, which is taking challenges in a different way.
Oh, thank you. So I have heard the most learned people. So I congratulate them that they are doing good things. But the problem is that we have to build the capacities of professors, because they are our teachers. So they are the most important person and resource. The teachers are not aware of, they are aware of, but they don't practice. See, I take the one example. Dr. Arun was purchasing calibrated instruments for non-communicable diseases. And our teachers, they just obsessed to theory, dietary assessment skill. We only give them a theory. I have never seen in any medical colleges a demonstration being given local mayors and cooked food converted into raw. So that is the missing most. I have visited almost 120 medical colleges of the states, and I was at a loss that they only talk theory. They have never demonstrated ke ye cooked hai, isme ra kitna hoga. This is a local mayor, how much does it contain in terms of milliliter? The second important point is that the teachers, they are again obsessed to teach whatever is the written prescription, the way the styles book have been written. The nutrition can be integrated vertically within the departments. The madam was complaining that we have been given only two competencies. The nutrition has to be taught in relation to communicable diseases, nutrition, immunization. I was very happy. I was talking to a district immunization officer. I told him, and he was convinced, and then he is practicing now. The best immunization is mother's milk. So he convinces the workers who are working at the ground level, the first immunization for child is breast milk. That is immunization. We talk about immunoglobulin, sir. We talk about protection, passive, active immunity. And he was convinced that this is passive immunity. Mother says, if you get immunity from the mother, if you get this, then it will not get dust. Okay, and its weight will be fine. Now, recently, the mother and child health protection card, which has been prepared jointly by Ministry of Health and Ministry of Child Welfare. So that card has been updated. Now that card, I see varieties of card, varieties of folders. I go to different medical colleges. They have prepared different family folder, and altogether different weight card, which is not in the system. So they have their own weight card and grading system. So that's the most unfortunate. Madam Pragati Chavda, I'll request you, kindly do only one good thing, that a child is weighed by mother and child is weighed by students, plotted accurately, then interpreted. So that those steps are to be followed, and we don't do it usually. It is seldom done. I congratulate you that you have done, you have built into the capacities you have brought out. But I am requesting to you, kindly don't mind, because I have been the professor and I have gone to the field several times and have brought many things, many innovation from the field to the classroom. So my request is kindly bring innovation being practiced in the field to classroom. There are several mechanisms, several ways of doing those things. And the other important issue is that this new updated mother and child protection card, it has added height for boys, height for girls. So that is a very difficult thing to do. How a infant is measured, infantometer, the students have never seen, even in the Department of Pediatric infantometer kya hota hai? कि एक बच्चे का छोटा बच्चा का उसकी हाइट लेनी है तो हमें उसको स्टेबल करना पड़ेगा एक इधर लगेगा एक उधर लगेगा एक पैर पकड़ेगा एक सिर पकड़ेगा सीधा करेगा तो इट इज़ अ डिफिकल्ट काइंड ऑफ अ थिंग एंड अ चाइल्ड हु कैन स्टैंड कैन हाउ ही कैन स्टैंड सो कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग इज़ अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इशू मैडम वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट सुपरविजन इट्स अ वेरी एसेंशियल and the supervisors in present day, that is the most weakest link. The supervisors, the guidelines for supervision, the standard guidelines are not available. Standard protocols are not available to the worker. The supervisor is free for all. The health supervisors, they don't report in the reporting system, which is a single format report originating from sub-central level. There is no column for the supervisor that what activities they have performed, they are never reported. So I am yearning that there is a report system for supervisors also. It should be inbuilt in the system. Otherwise, your supervision, my supports, your support, it is altogether eyewash. It doesn't stick. Unless it is into the system or institutionalized, the things will never work. I'm congratulating Dr. Qadri that I am part of the association. I was also trying for 9-10 years long. I was a secretary general of the association, but the success was very little. And so I am requesting that the most resistant factors and the pivotal factors are the teachers, the faculty, and they must change. Unless they change, we talk everything, anything about nutrition, and we talk most of the things, but I have undergone, and those persons who have undergone 3 months training at NIN, we have the premier, most world-reputed institute, NIN, Hyderabad. So if you want to learn public health nutrition or public nutrition, so nutrition that can be learned in those houses. I am not shying that a 5 days training or 2 days training of teachers in anthropometric measurement is a very cardinal, and dietary survey very cardinal. So with these words, I thank Dr. Arun, and we have been working together. One more message is there. Yes. The integration has been done in the system. The beautiful system is that how we demonstrate our capacity, that health, nutrition, and education have been integrated at the field level, at the level of Anganwadi worker. The three things, H-E-N. So we are failing to demonstrate effectively to our students, the learners, and learning capacities of the students are not being built. We are doing it in isolation. So my request is kindly do it in a more integrated way, because nothing prevents you. You can do it in wonders. Nutrition is not to be talked only in isolation. It is to be integrated with every subject, maternal and child health, disease, health promotion, sakti, sab. बता रहे थे अभी प्रमोशन में आता है बट इट इज नॉट ओनली वर्ब द होल साइंस ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन इज अ कम्युनिकेशन स्ट्रेटजी सर ग्रेन्स आर प्लेंटी इन होम्स एवरी हाउस इज अ ग्रेनरी एंड ओनली ब्रेन्स आर रिक्वायर्ड टू यूज दोज ग्रेन्स सर एंड बेस्ट ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन इज इन द फील्ड एंड फार्म एंड द टेक्नोलॉजी द प्रिजर्वेटिव टेक्नोलॉजी इंडिजिनसली आर मैक्सिमम अवेलेबल 10 different recipes are prepared by mothers, not by our formula or a home science nutrition, those girls or nurses. We implant our recipes on mothers, but we are failing to discover what recipes already exist and the mothers are practicing. Those are wonderful. So I have relied thoroughly on those recipes which are available in the home. Only question is, sir, the children are not given enough of food to eat. That is a misery, whole misery. The food grains are available, food is in plenty. We require 100 grams of grains for a child, young child, per day. And that is supplementation. So with these words, kindly don't mind.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your words of wisdom. And the last one or two comments, we close the session. Nutrition important tha, hai aur rahega. We were doing lot, but we were not able to accomplish much before. And now also, currently also, we are not able to do much. Lekin, ab ye opportunity hai to do much more. And to shift from cap, jo last era tha, wo cap ka tha, ab ye era hai, IR ka hai, kuch kar dikhane ki tamanna har man mein honi chahiye, ki hum chahe chota sa hi change kyun na karein. चाहे एक ही वर्कर की प्रैक्टिस, एक ही माल नरिश्ड बेबी को कम्युनिकेशन स्किल्स कैसे करना है, कहीं छोटा सा ही क्यों ना बदलाव करें, वो हमारे थीसिस प्रोजेक्ट्स में, रिसर्च में वो होना चाहिए. छोटा छोटा बदलाव, हर कोई एक दिया जलाएगा तो देखो क्या बन जाता है. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच.
SR Machta, professor and head, for felicitating our speakers. Nahi sir, photo bhi leni hai na. Dr. Shailesh, ma'am Pragati, Dr. Rambha, and Dr. Amir.
I don't take for that.
One second. Wait.
Eyes open.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.